Hawker Hurricane, mainstay of RAF Fighter Command in the Battle of Britain. In the fateful summer of 1940, two-thirds of Britain's monoplane fighters were Hurricanes. It was this unglamorous workhorse which bore the brunt of the fight against Hitler's aerial armada. During the battle, over 1,700 Hurricanes served with RAF Fighter Command, and Hurricanes accounted for two-thirds of all enemy aircraft shot down. The extraordinary achievements of the RAF's Hurricanes have long since been overshadowed by the legendary status of the powerful and elegant Spitfire. The Spitfire's all-metal structure made it a revolutionary aircraft, and its performance far outclassed the Hurricane. Yet, it was the Hurricane's rugged and old-fashioned simplicity which was its greatest asset. It could be produced quickly and cheaply in large numbers using well-tried techniques. And numbers were of the utmost importance. In 1940, the RAF was facing the largest and most formidable air force in the world. If the bomber fleets of the Luftwaffe had been met only by small numbers of Spitfires, the RAF and Britain herself would have been quickly overwhelmed. Instead, the outcome was a victory which changed the course of the Second World War. Simple as the Hurricane's technology would later appear, the aircraft incorporated a host of design features revolutionary in their day. It was a monoplane fighter at a time when many believed that monoplanes could never compete with biplanes in a dogfight. It was streamlined and boasted retractable undercarriage. It was the world's first 8-gun fighter and a remarkably fast aircraft. In 1935, when it was first flown, the Hurricane was capable of 315 miles per hour at 16,200 feet. Such speed would have been unimaginable in the days when the Hurricane's biplane predecessors wheeled over the trenches of the First World War. By 1917, the role of the fighter aircraft had been clearly defined. Its task was to win control of the skies over the battlefield and over rear areas, denying the enemy the opportunity to bomb, strafe, or spy. At the same time, the fighter was to prevent the enemy attacking its own aircraft as they performed these vital operations. The fighter had become a specialized instrument in the struggle for air supremacy. The most famous British fighter of the war deployed in 1917 was the Sopwith Camel. The Sopwith Company would in later years evolve into Hawker Engineering, creators of the Hawker Hurricane. The Sopwith Camel was a highly maneuverable aircraft, well suited to close combat. It was also the most heavily armed British fighter of its day, mounting two synchronized belt-fed Vickers machine guns. The Camel was typical of the First World War biplane fighter. Its fuselage was a box of bulkheads and spacers, braced internally by diagonal wires. The wings were made of wooden ribs mounted on spars, and the whole was covered in fabric. The rigidity of the entire structure depended on external spars and bracing wires. The Great War did see the development of some monoplane fighters, the most successful being the Fokker Eindecker. However, it was generally agreed that biplanes were far more agile in combat. The large total wing area of a biplane, combined with its narrow span, made for tremendous maneuverability. And in spite of monoplane developments, by the war's end, the most successful fighter aircraft was still a biplane, the Fokker D-7. The extraordinary success of the D-7 served only to confirm the belief that in a fighter aircraft, maneuverability was everything. And in this, the biplane would always outclass the monoplane. This conviction would seriously obstruct the development of monoplane fighters long after the Great War had ended. In the harsh economic climate of the post-war world, the aviation industries of even the victorious powers were hard hit. Demand slumped from tens of thousands of aircraft a year to barely a few thousand. The aircraft market was flooded with surplus military airframes, engines, and spares. The air forces of the world fared even worse. In Britain, the prevailing mood of disarmament and the rigors of economic necessity ensured that military budgets were slashed. As the most junior of the services, the newly constituted Royal Air Force suffered out of all proportion to its importance. The total number of British squadrons was soon reduced to below its pre-war level. In spite of the difficulties besetting both military and civil aircraft manufacturers, the post-war years nevertheless saw some of the greatest achievements in aviation history. In 1919, John Alcock and Arthur Witten Brown made the world's first non-stop crossing of the Atlantic. The journey took 16 hours and 12 minutes. In November 1923, Francesco J. Pinedo, in a Savoia Marchetti S-16, flew in 80 stages from Italy to Australia to Tokyo, a distance of 33,000 miles in 370 hours. As the public applauded the exploits of long-distance aviators and records for aircraft range and endurance were broken time and time again, the implications were not lost on the world's military planners. In any future war, aircraft flying great distances could bring death and destruction to the very heart of a nation. By the early 1930s, politicians, military leaders, and the public at large had become obsessed with the power of the bomber. And against massed bomber fleets, it was widely believed there could be no effective defense. The dogma that the bomber would always get through was so readily accepted that Britain's military power was judged by the air chiefs and by the British government almost solely in terms of its bomber strength. In addition, the chief of the air staff, Lord Trenchard, was quick to see that the bomber provided the Air Force with a strategic role as important, if not more important, than either the Navy or the Army. As a consequence, funds for the development of fighter aircraft were miserly in the extreme. What the bomber enthusiasts failed to appreciate was that recent technical advances held out the promise of fast and powerful fighter aircraft which could challenge and defeat even the most formidable bombers. It was in the United States that advances in petrochemical technology and the development of strong lightweight alloys paved the way for a new generation of high-performance aero engines. Such engines offered power beyond the wildest dreams of the designers of only a decade earlier. Yet, to realize the high-speed potential of advanced aero engines, radical changes would have to be made in the design of the aircraft themselves. Above all, drag must be reduced to an absolute minimum. The traditional biplane, still favored by the world's fighter pilots, posed intrinsic difficulties for the designer attempting to reduce drag. Although the biplane's four wings greatly increase agility, wing leading edges are a prime source of drag, and the biplane has four to the monoplane's two. Struts and cross bracing also cause drag, as does an open cockpit. Wind tunnel tests revealed that the biplane is subject to another inherent drawback known as biplane interference. The airflow around the upper wings disturbs that around the lower, seriously impairing performance. Gradually, it became apparent that a truly low-drag aircraft must be a monoplane. Even with monoplanes, traditional designs involved other important sources of drag. One was fixed undercarriage, and attempts were made to streamline these by fitting covers called spats. The ideal, however, would be undercarriage which retracted into the wings or body of the aircraft. Another problem for designers attempting to produce a truly streamlined aircraft was posed by the rotary engine. The circular arrangement of its cylinders caused high drag, and the larger and more effective the cooling fins on each cylinder, the worse the drag problem became. Cowlings were fitted around rotary engines in an attempt to smooth the airflow, but the basic problem remained. The solution was to adopt power plants in which the cylinders were in line, one behind the other. The first designers to try and combine in a single aircraft advanced engines and fuels and the maximum of streamlining were those competing in the annual Schneider Trophy speed trials. In 1926, an Italian monoplane flown by Mario De Bernardi roundly defeated the biplane of the American record holders. Bernardi's highly streamlined aircraft achieved an average speed of 246.5 miles per hour. Over the following 5 years, British attempts to beat the Italians in the Schneider competition led to the creation of a whole stable of state-of-the-art monoplane racers. In 1931, the Supermarine S6B, with a speed of 340 miles per hour, delivered the third successive British win, and the Schneider Trophy was awarded to Britain in perpetuity. Of far more importance for the future of British military aircraft was the engine developed by Rolls-Royce to power the winning racers. The direct descendants of this engine would power the next generation of British fighter aircraft. The first of the new breed would be the Hawker Hurricane. From thoroughbred racers to a reliable and combat-worthy fighter like the Hurricane was a long and arduous road. The operational life of the hand-built Rolls-Royce R-Series engine was only 1.5 hours. The engine of a combat aircraft must be able to take hundreds of hours of punishment, many of those hours at the limit of its performance. The engine must also be capable of mass production and easily maintained. The design principles which had inspired the airframe of the Supermarine S6 were just as difficult to incorporate into a viable fighter. The development of the Spitfire would demand whole new production techniques for working in stressed metal. The design of the Hurricane, however, would neatly circumvent many of these problems. The aircraft would be a halfway house between the old and the new. The man whose ingenuity combined in the Hurricane the most modern design principles with the simplest methods of manufacture was the chief designer of the Hawker Company, Sidney Cam. Cam had joined Hawker Engineering in 1924, and over the following 2 years had played a major role in developing the Hawker Horsley bomber. The Horsley was remarkable in that from 1928, its airframe incorporated metal tubing. Cam soon followed the Horsley with the Hawker Hart light bomber, which first flew in June 1928. The Hart's Rolls-Royce Kestrel engine gave it a top speed of 184 miles per hour, faster than the RAF fighters then in service. And as a result, a fighter version of the Hart called the Demon was produced, reaching RAF squadrons in 1931. Cam's next creation was a biplane fighter, the Hawker Fury. Capable of over 200 miles per hour, the Fury represented the pinnacle of Hawker's expertise in biplane design. However, by the time the Fury II entered service in December 1936, it was already obsolete. Germany under Adolf Hitler was rearming at a frantic pace, and German designers were creating monoplane bombers which threatened to outperform the fastest of British biplane fighters. While most of the British Air Ministry doggedly clung to their belief in the superiority of the biplane as a fighter, a few realized that maneuverability could be no substitute for speed. The only answer to the German bomber threat was a fast monoplane fighter. At the Hawker Company, Sidney Cam had come to the same conclusion. Cam's starting point was his own successful biplane fighter, the Hawker Fury. Cam was determined that the aircraft should be capable of being produced with existing jigs and tools. And at first, the new aircraft was to be in effect a monoplane Fury. He retained the Fury's biplane type airframe, a wire-braced framework of metal tubes and wooden formers. The hull was to be covered in fabric, along with the thick-bodied cantilever wings. In designing his low-drag monoplane fighter, Cam was faced with a series of extremely difficult problems. The wings had to be capable of withstanding the stresses and shocks of high-speed flight without the aid of struts and bracing wires. They would have to have great internal strength. Yet, the demands of streamlining meant that retractable undercarriage was highly desirable, and the wings would have to be thick enough to hold the landing gear. According to Air Ministry specifications, the average pilot must be capable of landing the aircraft on a field less than 1,250 yards long. The high landing speeds of a monoplane meant that the wheels must be fitted with brakes, and the undercarriage should ideally be widely spaced to give stability on bumpy grass airfields. Cam's solution was to make the undercarriage retract inwards so that the wheels themselves could be housed in the thickest part of the wings. CAM's design worked so well that unlike the Spitfire, whose landing gear retracted outwards, and as a result was narrow-tracked, few Hurricanes would be lost through grounding of the wingtips on rough airfields. The heart of Sydney CAM's monoplane interceptor was to be the Rolls-Royce PV-12 engine. The new engine was the direct descendant of the Schneider Trophy racing engines, a development of the Kestrel power plant first tested in late 1933. A V-shaped engine with cylinders in line, the PV-12 was perfectly shaped for the high degree of streamlining CAM needed in his new fighter. Ultimately, the inline configuration would cause unforeseen problems. Unlike radial engines, in which air freely circulates around the cylinder heads, an inline plant needs liquid cooling. In combat, the Hurricane's cooling system would prove extremely vulnerable to enemy fire. The PV-12 was fitted with a single-stage supercharger which delivered an increase in power of 60% over the Kestrel at high altitudes. As the Merlin C, the engine was rated at 1,030 horsepower. In January 1935, when CAM's Hurricane design was already well advanced, the Merlin C had not yet flown and was beset with teething troubles. It was August before the engine could be installed in the Hurricane prototype K5083. On November the 6th, at Brooklands Aerodrome, K5083 took to the air for the first time. Subsequent tests showed that the aircraft's performance was well up to expectations. At 16,000 feet, the prototype reached a top speed of 315 miles per hour. It was the beginning of a new era of British high-performance fighter aircraft. In February 1936, the prototype Hurricane was handed over to the aeroplane and armament establishment at Martlesham Heath for trials. The pilots who flew it were highly satisfied with the aircraft's handling qualities, although stick forces were heavy at high speeds. On June the 3rd, 1936, Hawkers received a production contract for 600 aircraft. And on June the 12th, the Air Ministry officially approved the name Hurricane for the new fighter. The original schedule called for the first Hurricanes to be delivered to the RAF in the early summer of 1937. In fact, because it was decided to wait for the new Merlin C engine, later renamed the Merlin II, the first production Hurricane L1547 did not fly until October. The months between prototype and delivery were spent by CAM and his team in refining the original design. The Hurricane's flaps were modified. The canopy of its enclosed cockpit went through five prototypes before a satisfactory design was found. The result combined good visibility, a matter of life and death to a fighter pilot, and the capacity to slide back easily for an emergency exit. Later, bulletproof glass would be fitted along with an armored firewall behind the instrument panel. Sydney CAM's original design had envisaged armament of four machine guns. But in 1934, the Air Ministry had decided that eight guns would be far more effective. High-speed combat might mean that the enemy would be in a pilot's gun sights for as little as 2 seconds at a time. And the weight of fire promised by eight guns would have a far greater chance of destroying him in a single pass. The ministry evaluated all the machine guns offered by the world's manufacturers and chose the American Colt Browning. It was an extremely reliable weapon, with the added advantage that it could be modified to take standard 303 British Army rifle bullets. The arrangement chosen was to mount two pairs of four guns each in the Hurricane's wings. To eliminate the need for synchronization gear, which slows down a gun's rate of fire, the Brownings were placed outside the arc of the propeller. Each machine gun was supplied with 300 rounds, allowing 14 seconds of continuous fire. Wing-mounted guns mean that the pilot could no longer lean out of his cockpit to remedy stoppages, as was the practice with biplanes. Here, the reliability of the Colt Browning, with its stoppage rate of only 1 in 15,000 rounds, was of vital importance. In early 1938, the conversion of RAF fighter squadrons to the Hurricane began in earnest. To pilots accustomed to slow biplanes, the change was often traumatic. Compared to biplanes, the high landing speed of the Hurricane led to many mishaps. The Merlin engine was also causing problems, sometimes cutting out for no apparent reason, with fatal consequences. The wooden two-bladed propeller, fitted as standard, was highly inefficient and made the aircraft feel underpowered in takeoff. However, from the end of 1938, production Hurricanes were fitted with the de Havilland three-bladed two-pitch metal propeller. And in spite of an increase in weight, the aircraft's climb performance was vastly improved. Other modifications included the addition of a ventral strake for better spin control. The tail wheel, which was designed to retract, was found to be unreliable and was instead fixed in the permanently down position. Even before the Hawker Hurricane had reached RAF squadrons in significant numbers, it had already had a profound impact on British defence strategy. The doctrine that the bomber would always get through had spurred a frantic bomber race with Germany. At the highest levels, it was firmly believed that if war came, the nation with the most powerful bomber fleet would inevitably win. It was the recently appointed Minister for the Coordination of Defence, Sir Thomas Inskip, who realised that the very existence of the new high-speed fighters changed everything. Inskip concluded that the bomber race was irrelevant. To the dismay of Air Marshal Trenchard, Inskip insisted that a sufficiently powerful fighter force would prevent enemy bombers from delivering the knockout blow that everyone feared. And since fighters were cheaper and faster to build than bombers, in a war of attrition, fighter defences would have a clear advantage. It was Inskip's insistence on increased fighter production that laid the foundations for victory in the Battle of Britain. On September the 1st, 1939, Hitler's armies stormed into Poland. On September the 3rd, Britain declared war on Germany. Within a week, the first units of the British Expeditionary Force arrived in France. Soon after came four squadrons of RAF Hurricanes. Sydney Cam's advanced monoplane fighter would soon receive its baptism of fire. As the Nazi juggernaut swept to victory in Poland, Britain and France, Poland's allies, failed to intervene. German and French artillery exchanged fire on the Franco-German border, while British bombers dropped propaganda leaflets on German cities. It was the beginning of the nine-month period of uneasy skirmishing known as the Phony War. The lull in military activity after the fall of Poland did not extend to the German Luftwaffe. In late October, high-level reconnaissance flights over France were mounted with increasing frequency. The intruders were invariably Dorner 17 twin-engine bombers. On October the 30th, one such aircraft was intercepted by an RAF Hurricane of No. 1 Squadron, flown by pilot officer P.W.O. Mole. The Dornier was the first aircraft shot down by an RAF fighter in the Second World War. On November the 8th, No. 73 Squadron scored its first victory. Another Dornier 17. It was the first kill for a Hurricane pilot who would become a legend, Flying Officer James Edgar Kane. Cobber Kane, a New Zealander, would become the RAF's top ace in the battle for France, with 14 victories to his credit. Within 2 weeks of Kane's first victory, RAF Hurricanes accounted for five more Dorniers and a Heinkel 111. It was clear that against the German bombers, the Hurricane's speed and firepower made it a deadly opponent. But the first clash with German fighters was yet to come. On December the 22nd, three Hurricanes of No. 73 Squadron patrolling the front line were bounced by German fighters diving from high altitude. Two Hurricanes were shot down and their pilots killed. It was the Hurricane's first encounter with the fighter that would prove its most formidable enemy in the Battle of Britain, the Messerschmitt 109. The 109 was armed with two synchronized machine guns on the engine crankcase, each with 1,000 rounds, and two wing-mounted cannon, each with 60 rounds. Its Daimler-Benz 601A engine was rated at 1,175 horsepower, more powerful than the Hurricane's Merlin II. It was also faster, with a top speed of 348 miles per hour, and at altitude far outclassed the Hurricane. The 109's fuel injection also meant that, unlike British fighters, which were fitted with carburetors, in combat, hard dives did not cause the engine to miss a beat. Nevertheless, the Hurricane did have two great advantages over its Messerschmitt rival. It could absorb far more punishment, and it could outturn the 109 in close combat. The early months of 1940 saw increasingly frequent German fighter sweeps deep into French territory, and the Luftwaffe's high-level reconnaissance aircraft were busier than ever. During this period, Hurricanes accounted for several more enemy aircraft. To many RAF Hurricane pilots in France, this upsurge in activity seemed to point to an imminent German offensive. On May the 9th, they were proved correct. German forces invaded Denmark and Norway. The following day came the assault on France and the Low Countries. In support of the German campaign in the West, the Luftwaffe had mustered over 4,000 aircraft, including 1,700 bombers and over 1,000 Me-109 fighters. Their first task was to smash Allied air power in Holland, Belgium and France. On the first day, 22 Allied airfields were attacked. At the outset, the Belgian and Dutch air forces were virtually destroyed. The French and British, however, with over 500 modern fighters, now including 8 squadrons of RAF Hurricanes, put up fierce resistance. On the first day, Allied fighters claimed 90 German aircraft destroyed for only 20 losses in the air. The following days saw equally impressive performance by Allied fighter defences. On May the 11th alone, Hurricanes of 501 Squadron claimed 6 enemy aircraft without loss to themselves. The following day, 12 German machines were destroyed at the cost of 2 Hurricanes. Such victories were a sign of what might have been possible if the Hurricane had been available in numbers. But in the event, the sheer numerical weight of the enemy made the outcome a foregone conclusion. Even as RAF forward airfields were being abandoned in the face of overwhelming German pressure, reinforcements of 32 Hurricanes were dispatched from Britain in a vain attempt to stem the Nazi tide. The French government was pleading for a further 120 aircraft, but Sir Hugh Dowding, head of RAF Fighter Command, doggedly resisted depleting his already weakened fighter strength. By May the 17th, 71 RAF Hurricanes had been lost in France. And with brutal honesty, Dowding pointed out that if the current rate of losses continued, there would not be a single Hurricane left in France or Britain within a fortnight. On May the 21st, all but 2 Hurricane squadrons were evacuated to England. Many were forced to destroy their aircraft to prevent them falling into German hands. With the battle for France all but lost and the British Expeditionary Force converging on Dunkirk in the hope of evacuation, Hurricanes were once more sent into the thick of battle. This time their role was to defend the British Expeditionary Force and the evacuation fleet from total destruction by the Luftwaffe. To the soldiers on the ground, hammered incessantly by German bombers and dive bombers, it seemed as if the RAF was doing little to help them in their plight. Yet, to provide air cover for the evacuation from Dunkirk, 16 squadrons of Hurricanes and Spitfires flying from bases in southern England were in action at any one time. As losses mounted, squadrons were replaced, until by the end of the Battle of Dunkirk on June the 4th, 32 RAF squadrons, including 25 squadrons of Hurricanes, had seen combat over the Channel ports. They had destroyed 132 German aircraft. The cost to the RAF had been fearful. 99 fighters had been lost covering the evacuation. And since the German invasion of France, total RAF fighter losses were 477, including over 300 Hurricanes. Only 367 Hurricanes and Spitfires now remained for the defense of Britain. In the aftermath of the battle for France, Fighter Command was in a dangerously weakened condition. But for those responsible for the defense of Britain, there was one shred of comfort. The RAF's new fighters, the Hurricane and the Spitfire, had proved themselves to be remarkable aircraft. Even pitted against the Messerschmitt 109, the Hurricane could hold its own at all but the highest altitudes. From the thousands of combats in which Hurricanes had by now taken part, a great deal had been learned. The lives of many pilots in France had been saved by the unofficial fitting of armor plate behind the aircraft seats. And as a result, all Hurricanes were now fitted with full armor as standard. At high altitudes, cold condensation had often led to the Hurricanes' Browning machine guns freezing. The solution was to dilute the gun's lubricating oil with paraffin. Moisture entering the gun barrels as the Hurricane flew through cloud also caused severe problems. To prevent this, gun muzzles were taped over with fabric so that moisture could no longer penetrate, at least until the guns were first fired. Later, both problems would be solved by warming the guns with hot air fed from the engines. In the light of experience, Hurricane pilots now harmonized their guns at 200 yards range instead of the official 650 yards. The result was a much more destructive concentration of fire. Other modifications improved the performance of the aircraft. In January 1939, a Hurricane had been successfully tested with the Rotol three-bladed constant speed propeller. Because the propeller automatically adjusted its pitch under all conditions of air resistance and engine revs, the effect was a better rate of climb and very much reduced engine wear, a factor of critical importance where aircraft were stretched to the limit. Over 1,000 Hurricanes and Spitfires would be fitted with Rotol or de Havilland constant pitch propellers by the time the Battle of Britain reached its climax. In April 1939, the first Hurricane with metal-skinned wings had been flown. And from March 1940, all new production aircraft had been metal-winged. The reduced drag and the fitting of new Merlin III engines gave yet a further increase in the Hurricane's top speed. Within 2 weeks of the fall of France, German plans for the invasion of Britain were already being drafted. Hitler and his generals clearly understood that success would depend on the Luftwaffe winning mastery of the skies over southern England. Hermann Göring calculated that 4 days of intensive air operations would be enough to overwhelm Britain's southern air defenses. A further 4 weeks would see the total destruction of the RAF. The Luftwaffe assembled 2 full air fleets in France and a 3rd in Denmark and Norway, 2,800 combat aircraft. Eagle Day, scheduled for early August, was to mark the beginning of the Great Offensive. 5 weeks later, the German invasion force would cross the Channel. While the Luftwaffe was preparing for Eagle Day, the RAF was not to be left unmolested. To wear down British fighter strength, Göring ordered his bombers to attack British ports and Channel convoys. If the RAF sent its fighters to intercept the raiders, they would suffer losses that Britain could ill afford. If the British failed to rise to the bait, the price would be heavy losses of valuable shipping. By July the 1st, RAF Fighter Command possessed 57 squadrons of modern fighters. Of these, 29 were of Hurricanes. 17 of the Hurricane squadrons were part of Number 11 Group, the sector which would bear the brunt of the fighting in the Battle of Britain. The first major action for the RAF's Hurricanes came on July the 13th, when 11 aircraft of No. 56 Squadron encountered a large force of Stuka dive bombers escorted by Messerschmitt 109s. The Hurricanes claimed the destruction of 7 dive bombers for the loss of 2 aircraft. Sir Hugh Dowding, Chief of Fighter Command, was determined to conserve his fighters for the battle to come, and so committed his Hurricanes and Spitfires in the smallest numbers possible. Yet by the end of July, after 3 weeks of battle, the RAF had lost 46 Hurricanes and 32 Spitfires. 50 pilots had been killed. On the 8th of August, 15 Hurricanes and Spitfires were lost in a single day. And on August the 10th, 30 RAF fighters were destroyed for only 35 raiders shot down. This was a rate of attrition that the RAF could not hope to sustain, and the Battle of Britain had not yet begun in earnest. On August the 12th, the Luftwaffe mounted its first major raids against RAF radar stations and forward airfields. The airfield suffered heavy damage, but Fighter Command's radar cover was only slightly impaired. 36 German aircraft were shot down for the loss of 13 Hurricanes and 6 Spitfires. It was the prelude to the Eagle Offensive, the assault, which Goering had promised would destroy the RAF in southern England in 4 days. Between August the 13th and August the 18th, every Fighter Command airfield between the Thames estuary and the Solent was targeted by the bombers of the Luftwaffe. 34 airfields and radar stations were attacked, some time and time again. Totally outnumbered, the RAF's defending fighters suffered heavily. Interruption of radar cover severely hampered interceptions, but nevertheless, August the 15th was the worst day yet for the German raiders. 71 enemy aircraft were destroyed for the loss of 29 Hurricanes and Spitfires. As the Battle of Britain grew in ferocity, the Hurricane became more and more highly prized by the pilots who flew it and the commanders whose task it was to preserve the RAF as an effective fighting force. Scrambling sometimes several times a day to face massed bomber fleets with powerful fighter escorts, Hurricane pilots could at least be certain that they were flying the most robust and damage-resistant fighter aircraft possessed by either side. Even the cannon fire of the Messerschmitt 109 often failed to destroy a Hurricane. During the course of the battle, hundreds of Hurricanes succeeded in returning to their airfields with a degree of damage no other fighter could possibly have withstood. In comparison with the Spitfire, in combat, the Hurricane also had another important advantage. Because of its thick wings, the Hurricane's 8 guns could be grouped more closely together than the Spitfires, and as a result, their fire was far more concentrated. The many Hurricane aces of the Battle of Britain were men who could use this hitting power to the fullest advantage. Douglas Bader, who had lost both legs in a flying accident before the war, commanded 242 Squadron for most of the battle, and flying a Hurricane accounted for 11 German aircraft. Ginger Lacey of 501 Squadron had shot down 5 German aircraft in France. In the Battle of Britain, he accounted for 18 more, becoming the RAF's highest scoring ace of the battle. Joseph František, a Czechoslovak pilot of 303 Polish Squadron, accounted for 17 German aircraft. If proof were needed that in the hands of courageous and skillful pilots, the Hurricane was a formidable fighter, the performance of 303 Squadron alone would suffice. In September, 303 Squadron flying Hurricanes achieved the highest kill rate in fighter command. By the end of the Battle of Britain, 695 Hurricanes had been lost in action. 1,537 German aircraft had been destroyed, more than two-thirds of these by Hurricanes. The Hawker Hurricane, brainchild of Sidney Cam, had utterly justified the faith of its creator, of the Royal Air Force, and of the many hundreds of pilots who flew it. In the Battle of Britain, the Hurricane had seen its finest hour. But from late 1940 and throughout 1941, it played its part with equal distinction in North Africa, the Mediterranean, and the Balkans. For service in these theatres, a tropical filter was fitted in a streamlined cowling beneath the engine. Over 2,000 Hurricanes served with RAF and Red Air Force units in the Soviet Union. These included over 200 Mark IIA Hurricanes fitted with a new Merlin 20 engine. The Merlin 20 greatly improved the Hurricane's performance, particularly its rate of climb. In all theatres, by 1941, the Hurricane's 8-gun armament was less than adequate in dealing with increasingly heavily armoured and faster opponents. A temporary solution to the problem was the Hurricane Mark IIB. The 2B was fitted with an extra 4 Browning machine guns, bringing its total to 12 and increasing its hitting power by 50%. What was needed, however, was a cannon-armed Hurricane. First introduced in the summer of 1941, the Mark IIC was armed with 4 Hispano 20mm cannon. And the innovation was so successful that 80 RAF squadrons would be equipped with Mark IICs. By 1942, the Hurricane had been all but superseded as a frontline fighter aircraft by the more easily upgraded Spitfire. But the Hurricane's operational life was far from over. The extremely effective Hurry bomber played a key tactical role in every theatre of RAF operations. And ground attack became the primary function of the Hurricane for the remainder of the war. Effective as 4 20mm cannon could be against armoured vehicles, a much heavier weapon was required. The Hurricane Mark IID, which first saw action in June 1942, was armed with 2 Vickers 40mm cannon and 2 machine guns for sighting. In North Africa, the Mark IID wreaked havoc with Axis armoured formations and supply columns. In a single day in March 1943, a squadron of Mark IIDs destroyed 32 tanks in 3.5 hours. By the end of 1943, the Hurricane was being phased out as an operational aircraft in the European theater. Even the rocket-firing Mark IV, the ultimate in ground attack Hurricanes, was quickly superseded by the faster Typhoon. Hurricanes would continue to do sterling work in the Far East, but elsewhere, the Hurricane's long and distinguished career was drawing to a close. In a 7-year period, 14,533 Hurricanes had been built in British and Canadian factories. The last, PZ-865, was completed in September 1944. PZ-865 is preserved by the RAF's Battle of Britain Memorial Flight in memory of RAF pilots who gave their lives in combat. It also serves as a fitting tribute to an extraordinary aircraft. An aircraft of which it can truly be said that it changed the course of history.